Good morning and welcome back to my channel and morning devotions. My name is Maggie. If this is your first time stopping by, I hope you decide to like and subscribe and click that notification bell and then come back and check out some of the other content I have on my channel. It is Saturday, November the 4th, I believe. Yeah. Yes, Saturday, November 4th. I had to check, you know, when you have some travel and then some other things happen in life. Obviously, I'm back home, as is my husband. He was discharged last night. Everything looks great, and I'll talk more about that at the end. Our devotions are coming from Joyce Meyer's book called Trusting God Day by Day, which is what I was doing yesterday. And our devotion today is No More Selective Hearing. And that's in quotes. No more selective hearing. Okay, I want to hear this because I know God speaks to me, and I just sometimes, you know, we don't listen because we think it's us. All right. Our scripture comes from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 3, verse 7, out of the Amplified Bible, and it reads, "But the house of Israel will not listen to you and obey you, since they will not listen to me and obey me. For all the house of Israel are impudent and stubborn of heart." Okay, let's hear how Joyce breaks this down. God has taught me that when we are unwilling to hear in one area, it may render us unable to hear in other areas. Sometimes we choose to turn a deaf ear to what we know the Lord is clearly saying to us. We only hear what we want to hear. It's called selective hearing. That's very similar to people picking and choosing scripture they want to listen to and scripture they want to embrace and others they want to ignore. Scripture is scripture and it is what it is. Okay. A woman once shared with me that she asked God to give her direction concerning what he wanted her to do. He clearly put in her heart that he wanted her to forgive her sister for an offense that had happened between them months earlier. Because this woman wasn't willing to do so, she pulled away from her prayer time. When she did seek the Lord again for something, he responded, "Forgive your sister first." Over a period of 2 years, every time she asked the Lord for guidance about something new, he gently reminded her, "I want you to forgive your sister." Finally, she realized that she would never grow spiritually if she didn't do the thing God had told her to do first. She got on her knees and prayed, "Lord, give me the power to forgive my sister." And that's a good lesson right there, because she apparently in her flesh could not. She wasn't willing because she was so offended and hurt. And when we know we must forgive, but we know we're not capable of it, this is a great prayer to pray. Give me the power to forgive my sister, to forgive my attacker, to forgive my dad, to forgive my boss, to forgive whoever, for whatever. Instantly, she understood many things from her sibling's perspective that she hadn't considered before. And within a short time, their relationship was healed and made stronger than it had ever been before. If we really want to hear from God, we can't approach him with selective hearing, hoping to narrow the topics down to only what we want to hear. Okay, we can't, guys. We can't. People want God's direction when they have issues they want solved. Don't just go to God and talk to him when you want or need something. Spend time with him just listening. And I'll be honest, I do struggle with the just being still and listening. I'm an active person. I'm proactive, active, and sitting there, I'm sometimes like, so how long do I have to sit here? Because then my mind starts jumping around. I must have attention deficit. I don't know. I think better when I'm pacing, when I'm praying, but it's never affected my schoolwork or my ability to focus or anything. But, you know, I tell the Lord, help me to calm my thoughts. That's the helmet of salvation is key. It's like the first piece I put on just so I can bring my mind into focus. but I want to hear and listen to the Lord. He will open up many issues if you will be still before him and simply listen. Now, I know this forgiveness thing is very real. I don't want to cast any aspersions or give anyone the wrong impression of my mother, but she was a very emotionally broken, out of balance person when I was growing up. She came from a home where there was sexual abuse taking place. Her father, he passed away when she was 14 before anything could ever happen between them. But I have zero doubts that her sisters were all affected by his sin. And when you grow up in a home where people are keeping that kind of a secret, you know, you don't bring people over for socializing. And so you don't develop proper social skills and you're insecure and there's all things that are skewed, you know, that in the way that you view things. And because of that and growing up that way, her way of processing, and I've said this before, she has these filters in place that looks for your insult and anything you say to her. And especially if I've again said this before in previous things, it could be something simple like, "Ooh, it's going to be 50 degrees today." And, or she could say that and you could say, "Oh, I thought it was going to get to 55. She's out, teeth and claws bared, and she's, "Are you calling me stupid?" I mean, it's something as simple as that. And just the fact that you watch two different weather reports on different stations. I mean, something that small and that minute would set her off. And I was just like, wow, it's hard to grow up with a nagging, contentious mother who looks at everything from her perspective. And it's hard. But then she endured a lot of people putting her down and these other things growing up. So there's not a healthy self-esteem. And I remember really, really, really struggling with forgiveness as a brand new baby Christian. And I would get up, I would just be in tears, so frustrated at the way she behaved and acted, and knowing that I, you know, being hurt that I couldn't have relationship with her the way I wanted to, because she was so walled off and not trusting of anyone, and everything was about her, and very narcissistic. Okay, lots of manipulation and things going on there. And finally, when I just chose to forgive, God really helped me to see things from her perspective. When I chose to forgive my dad, you know, because he was absent and not present, and he refused to invest in my twin sister's futures by paying for college, didn't offer any assistance, like even help. Like, I'm not going to do it, but this is what you can do. Let's apply here. Let's apply there. I didn't feel there was anybody in my corner when I was graduating high school to give me any kind of a direction of what I was supposed to do and where I was supposed to go. And, you know, feeling lost, you know, what am I? I had things I wanted to do. I did want to go to college, but I had no idea how to go about that. So I joined the military and started going to college in the military. But anyway, and I was proud to do it. But even forgiving him, God showed me, how would you behave? Lots of grace, you know, regarding my father. He was married once before at the age of 19. And his wife was 16, his first wife, when they married. There's my two older sisters' mother. And they were divorced, I want to say, within 3 years because of her infidelity, which the Bible says is a reason to divorce. Well, in the Catholic Church, they apparently forget about Corinthians, and they said he was excommunicated. And in the Catholic Church, that means you're going to hell. There's nothing you can do now. If you're excommunicated, nothing you can do at all, ever, to make it to heaven. They're forgetting that pesky little thing called grace. It's by grace we're saved. But I digress. How would you act if you were told that? Someone has broken their marriage vows, clearly broken the marriage vows, and my sister Cassie is a product of that infidelity because she's not connected to my dad genetically at all. My mother legally adopted both of them, We just recently found this out, by the way. It was always kind of a suspicion, but we just recently got the proof with a DNA test. But how would you act? You would live life to the full and enjoy and indulge in anything and everything, I would imagine, if you felt there's nothing I can ever do. But meanwhile, who was the volunteer Santa Claus for the base? Who was the one who was giving his time and his energy to mentally underdeveloped, you know, Down Syndrome Boy Scouts? He was a scout leader for the Down Syndrome Boy Scouts. Nobody wanted them in their troop. And so he formed his own troop just for these Boy Scouts to teach them stuff. Who was the volunteer Santa Claus for the orphanage in the Philippines, and who used his time and energy to support that orphanage? You know, who, you know, he did things like this all the time, very civically involved, very. And I'm like, his time, money, and energy went into these wonderful projects that had a huge impact on people. And I'm like, wow, you know. And I thought, Lord, let him find you. I was always in prayer, Lord, let him find you, because there was goodness inside him. He was a product of his generation. You make the money, you support the family, you know. And my poor mother, you know, the Lord gave me insight. How would you act if this was happening? And so I got insight into a lot of things, and I was able to release with grace, you know, the ones that had were the source of a lot of hurt of me growing up. You know, I wouldn't say I was physically abused, not by any stretch of the imagination, but there was a lot of distance. Okay. And then there was a lot of, in my mom's case, you know, like manipulation and, you know, not really being clear as to why you're being punished and, you know, stuff like it was really kind of, but God used it. He kept me, he sustained me, and he used it to teach me how to be a parent, you know, and he started doing that when I was super little. But anyway, I really encourage you, if you're struggling, releasing that person, no matter who it is and no matter what they've done, ask the Lord for the power to forgive, because he requires it of us. And he wouldn't ask you to do anything that he wouldn't strengthen you to do. Okay? There's nothing that happens in this life that is worth the sacrifice of your soul into an eternal hell. Because if you can't forgive, he can't forgive you. And I said, I don't care what it is. Lord, I know you will give me the ability to forgive, because I'm not giving up my heavenly home just because I want to stay mad. Forgiveness does never justify a wrongdoing. It releases you. Okay? All right. Our trust in him today. Is there anything God has spoken to you that you have not yet obeyed? Only you know that. Why are you hesitating? And trust God to give you the strength to do whatever he has asked you to do, knowing that he always has your best interests in mind. Your obedience will lead to your blessing. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just thank you for this day. I thank you for your goodness. I thank you, Father, that you are safe to trust. No matter what we're facing, no matter what we're going through, we can trust you. I thank you, Father, for leading us by your Holy Spirit. Help us, give us hearts willing to obey you, eyes to see and ears to hear you clearly. We thank you, Father, that you are moving us. Your desire is to bless us and give us life to the full. Help us to not be afraid to be obedient. Whether you're asking a hard thing, forgiveness towards someone who has done us seriously wrong, or even just an easy thing of step here and go here, pursue this career path because I've gifted you for it. Father, I thank you that you are with us, that you've never left us, you've never forsaken us. And I give you all the glory for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you, and thank you so much for stopping by my channel. As you guys know, yesterday, devotions were done in my husband's hospital room, which is like, yikes. I think I shared a little bit yesterday, but I'll just kind of recap for everyone. I arrived home from New Hampshire. My husband picked me up at the airport. He was a little kind of standoffish, which, you know, if he's preoccupied, that's kind of not unusual. But, you know, I grabbed, he grabbed my suitcase and then we were going home and he never mentioned a word about feeling weird or odd. So I walked through the door, my daughter Sarah's there and I'm like, hi, honey, you know, and I've got my things and I went into my bag to pull out some maple cookies that I bought that aren't in this area. And the maple's a big thing in New Hampshire because, you know, Vermont is close by and all that. So anyway, he said, hey, Sarah, I want you to listen to my heart. She goes, out of curiosity or do you have a concern? He goes, I just got a concern. I feel weird. I feel strange. You know, I was playing basketball and I just started playing 21 with someone, which is just two people playing against each other to see who makes 21 points first. It's not that strenuous of a activity. And he had just started. He goes, this fatigue hit him so bad. It's like every muscle in his body just felt fatigued. He had to step off the court, lean against the wall of the gym. He said he felt a little bit lightheaded. And he said he finished playing a little bit. Then he came home, had his dinner, and then went to the airport to pick me up. So my daughter got her stethoscope because she's studying to be a PTA. And part of that is taking vitals and all that. So she has her own stethoscope. She listened and she was like, Dad, that's not normal. You need to go get that checked out. So we went to the ER and it turns out he has AFib, atrial fibrillation. And that is a disruption in the proper rhythm of the heart. It's the most common thing. People can have AFib and not even know it. And the biggest concern with AFib is the chamber that sends out the electrical message or the pulse to tell your heart to beat. It's communicating to the lower part of the heart, which is where the pump is to pump everything out, is that it's not going to pump effectively and you're going to have blood pool on the bottom of the heart and then start to congeal and then throw a clot and then stroke or heart attack. That's the main thing with AFib is that. So they, when you get AFib, they generally will put you on a blood thinner to make sure you're not clotting and then you can go about your business. It's a type of AFib that is not consistent. It just comes and goes because his heart went back into its own rhythm on its own, which I think is what has happened in the past. And so they put him on a Maltac, which is a pill to keep his heart from going into AFib. So it's going to keep it at a steady rhythmic pace. And then Plavix because he can't take aspirin. Now his risk factors are so low, they say, we really don't need to put you on a blood thinner, but if you'd like one, we can give you Plavix because aspirin, he's got a stomach thing. And they said, no aspirin, no ibuprofen. So he's like, okay. So they put him on Plavix, which is a substitute for aspirin. So it's like taking an aspirin pill and then taking the thing that keeps his heart in rhythm. And then they told him just rest for, take it easy for about 2 to 3 weeks, and then you can resume playing basketball. And he goes, I'm kind of done with basketball. But anyway, he's doing great. They released him last night. He's going to go about his business. We're going to be getting him one of these, a fitness tracker, which I recommend if you guys want to get one. This, I got mine for accountability because I know I need to be up moving. I know I need to be getting about 10,000 steps a day, which is a great way to just make sure that you're not sitting down and being inactive or sedentary. If you're physically able to get up and move, I think we need to be getting up and moving. So I got mine just for step counting. And it'll remind you and everything else, but it also tracks your sleep. It tracks your heart rate. It tells you when you're in the zone, when you're not in the zone. So it would provide great data for my husband as, you know, he's moving about his day and then figuring out which activities would throw him into AFib. We're going to be getting one of those for him as well. But he is going to be wearing a heart monitor for the cardiologist. He'll get that on Monday. And they'll have their own information from the heart monitor. I think they'll have, like, while he's wearing it, they'll have something in their office that's tracking what's going on with that heart monitor. I'm pretty sure. So anyway, and that gives them a lot of good information, as you know, this is the first time he's ever had anything with this. But I want to tell you about the peace of God, because God is safe to trust. And if you're ever in a situation where something scary like that happens, potentially scary, I mean, the cardiac stuff is no joke, okay? It's no joke. He wasn't having chest pain or a heart attack, and they did his labs and everything came back clear. He was not having a heart attack, which I was never afraid of. I knew he wasn't. So I'm like, having confidence in God's word, and especially when he has promised things to you through his word, and even through the dreams and the things that he gives to you and your spouse or your family. You know, my husband and I want to travel, and we have prayed and asked the Lord for that. And I have felt a quiet peace and a confidence that we are going to be doing that. The Lord has shown me the places my husband and I are going to be going together and enjoying vacation together, in places like Israel, in places like Italy and Europe, all over Europe. I'm going to be experiencing those things with him. I have a confidence in me that's going to happen. I'm going to be taking him to the Philippines to show him where I grew up and where I went to high school, and introduce him to my nanny and see her face to face. I've asked those things of the Lord, and I have gotten a yes from him that I'm going to do that, that I'm going to bring my husband. So yesterday, when those scary things were happening and the enemy, you know, the enemy was there trying to make me feel that those things won't happen. I said, devil, you are a liar. God is safe to trust, and he cannot lie. So I began to praise God and thank God that he is going to get to the bottom of all this, and he is going to strengthen him. And not that the AFib necessarily will stop altogether. That could just be a normal functioning of the heart. But it's teaching my husband where his limits are, because he's one of those ones that'll push through and make things happen, you know. He's trying to push himself for peak performance. I said, you're not 23 anymore, honey. You're 57. So it's teaching him his limits, but it was also showing us God is good, because if he had this condition with his heart and we never knew about it, and he did develop a clot, and while we're traveling, him die, you know what I'm saying? Now we're aware and we're taking action to do things to make sure that stuff doesn't happen. I mean, I'm like, God, you are so good. You know the exact right time. And there's no reason why. The doctor said, you can resume everything. You're not restricted from any activity. We want you to take it easy on the basketball. But golf and all that other stuff, keep on going. Keep on doing it. So I was like, okay, great. So don't be afraid of things like that. God is faithful. He uses everything. And I just give him praise and glory, because I was never once did I allow fear to overtake me. Because I know what God promised me in my spirit. And it wasn't just my mind. It is things that I have prayed in agreement. There are words that have been spoken to us. God specifically said to us that we would have a long life together. It was a prophetic word. A couple of people have actually spoken that and affirmed it and confirmed it. Said, you and I are growing old. This is not going to happen. Okay. So anyway, trust what God says, and don't let the devil steal your peace. Don't let him steal your peace of mind and introduce fear. Okay. He's a liar. Well, God bless you guys. I do hope you decide to like and subscribe. I hope you are lifted up and encouraged, because I know things happen in life. Things happen in life. Our only trustworthy constant is God the Father. God is the only thing we can rely on. He will never let us down. Just because things happen we don't expect doesn't mean God has disappointed you or let you down. Life has just happened, and God is there to get you through it. Okay? Christians don't live in a bubble where nothing ever happens to them that's bad. All right? We live in a fallen world. Things are going to happen. We have to make sure we are putting our trust where it needs to be, and that's in God. God bless you guys. I hope you have a wonderful Saturday. Bye until next time.